after a lunch break, this session is going to be something that the Literature Festival has not yet touched upon. But this year, we're really talking about textiles and fashion from the perspective that how relevant it is for us to understand our role, because we are the consumers. We are the people who embrace our textiles. We are the people who really are looking for an identity when it comes to even embracing fashion. And while we are going to be hosting the Fashion Colloquia from tomorrow, the Fashion Colloquia is an international country-based destination event. And it has already been in 15 countries. And India Arch College of Design and Business is hosting it from tomorrow onwards. And it's a two-day affair. We've got 60 researchers in fashion who are traveling from 15 countries here to be amidst us. And we have tied up with the Jaipur Literature Festival, and Sanjoy has been really kind to be on the advisory and take on this whole idea of having the Literature Festival also address fashion as a very important area, because it has a huge impact on people, the profits and the planet. While we've been all talking about the negative side of fashion, there is a lot that fashion can bring forth. And we have here a very special panel who are completely into the space of fashion when it talk about from the management perspective or the research domain or as a practitioner here. So we have here with us Sanjay Garg, whom we all know as Raw Mango. And it's a privilege that Sanjay, coming from a rural background, from a small province near Alwar city, thought of studying design and did not get an approval from the family, and somehow fate chose him to really take on design. And after, you know, having studied his master's and then really taking on a course much later in life, that he's today, we see him as one of the most accomplished designers who's actually taking textile heritage of India to the international platform. So thank you, Sanjay, for being here with us.
Thank you.
Yeah. We have Professor Anik Shkrami. Professor Anik is at the University of Antwerp. She is a professor in business and economics and management there. And because we all know about the Antwerp Six, who actually created a rage in the European fashion scenario, much earlier, around the 80s, Anik and her school at the management school have a very special fashion management program, which is a global program, looking at why fashion and management is really important when we are really wanting to address a responsible future.
Thank you.
Welcome, Anik, amongst us. We have Professor Ian King, who's somebody who's very special because he heads the research at the University of Arts, London, and with the London College of Fashion, and instrumental in taking the fashion colloquium across the globe. He started with the four big fashion schools, London College of Fashion, Parsons, Domus, and IFM Paris, and then they were looking at the emergence of new fashion locations. So it went across to Brazil, Vietnam, China, and now with India, we are opening the third series on responsible future. And I felt, because this is the 150th year of Gandhi, and it becomes all the more significant that India has a voice when it comes to talking about fashion, because decolonizing of fashion is something that we really need to address, while we've been all trying to look at fashion from a very Western perspective or a European perspective. And that's what Professor Ian would bring, his contribution of traveling across the globe and talking about the textile heritage, the fashion which each of these nationalities have actually looked at. Welcome, Professor Ian, here with us. We have Himanshu Vardhan, and the session is powered with Etsy. And Etsy is a very new e-commerce platform to India, but started much earlier in the United States in the year 2005. And they believe in humanizing commerce. That was a very interesting tagline, because they see a designer in not a taught designer, but a designer who's actually got the flair for something, wants to take it out to the marketplace, have it been appreciated as something that both has form and function. So they are giving a marketplace for all these young people who are actually aiming to become designers. And I think Etsy has a great contribution, and they have actually grown the market by 200% in the last 3 years. And that's commendable. So welcome Himanshu to the panel. So we have a very exciting and enriching conversation that we're going to be looking at. And I'm going to bring forth different perspectives when we talk about textile heritage. And we are all very fond of our heritage. We all want to be very possessive about it. Because that gives us an identity, especially when you're an Indian. I think it becomes, you know, at least we are truly passionate about it. But when you look at the younger generation today, are they equally passionate about it? If they are, then it would have some meaning for it to stay. Otherwise, it's likely that we are going to be losing out on it, like the Western world has lost it already. So I was talking to a professor from Netherlands who said that because we do not have these handcrafts with us anymore, we are looking into the new crafts, that the new craftsmanship, which is into the digital space. The use, the embracing the new technologies. And we are developing new pedagogies there to look at, and new craftsmanship is the future. So now there's a whole new conversation that I'm going to start here with, looking at the textile heritage, where 3D technology, digital fashion, digital textiles are coming in. So where do you see Sanjay in terms of the local, the indigenous craft that we have here, and the textile heritage? How long do you see the future of this?
So, well, first of all, as you rightly said, you know, whatever you wear, to me, I think fashion, what give you is a individual expression, and what makes fashion to you is that whatever you wear is a certain communication. So if a man has a short hair, a woman has a long hair, or you wear this kind of blouse, you know he's a boy, I'm a girl. So whatever you wear, whatever you have in your, like, a body to express, or the glasses, what you're wearing, a sari, or with a bangle, or with a blouse, everything is an expression that who you are, and what you care for. So I think when you think of a fashion, you can't think of a fashion in a global world, which global is such a trendy word today. You can't see everyone thinking of that's a fashion, that's a trend, that lets everyone wear a trouser and t-shirt, or maybe everyone dress up like a Nike. I think we have to see a fashion in a very much regionality and individuality. How does India will dress up? And in India also, you can't really impose, let's say, if you say a sari is a national identity, but you can't really impose on, say, Kashmir, or to say to Punjab. So everyone need to have, it's a very personal freedom expression, right? So I think what fashion need to do is come down to a regional identity, and how does one express? And at the same time, the heritage, as you said, I heard that Netherlands doesn't have one, but if we have one, should not also be a burden. Not, I don't want to wear a lungi, or not, I cannot ask my young sister to wear a sari because, you know, I tell her, you know, that's her identity and that's heritage, you have to wear one. I think it's going to be like a language, let's say English language. It need to welcome different word from all different world. You know, everything is welcome. You need to welcome the new word from different languages. I think that's what heritage or textile or sari, it can only live longer if we welcome the changes, and it goes through the today's changes.
Wonderful. That's Professor Anik, because Antwerp 6 really created, and I was at Antwerp, and you got me to meet Dries Van Noten, who is the Antwerp 6 and the name from that city. So from the European perspective, how are you seeing this, the craftsmanship, the traditional heritage of the textiles that the Parisian or the, you know, the European world actually gave to the world in terms of looking at fashion? So how is it really evolving, and where do you see the new generation? Have they embraced it? What are your views on it?
Yes, thank you. Maybe I should explain a bit more about Antwerp 6 for those who don't know them. But indeed, in the 80s of the previous century, six Antwerp designers went to London and to Paris, and they became very famous because of their personal avant-garde style. So it was very creative, but it was not really based on craftsmanship. So it was really about the individual creativity. But of course, when we talk about Europe is the sum of different states, of different cultures. So the tagline of Europe, the European Union, is unity in diversity. So each country has its own fashion tradition. And the luxury labels in France and in Italy, of course, they have a real tradition and also in craftsmanship. The haute couture houses in France are really based on this craftsmanship. And you still can visit them, these small ateliers, in small places. But most of the people there are really old women who are, still know the craftsmen. So it's really also, there is a danger that the transfer of this knowledge is going to disappear. But we see as a reaction on globalization that also in Europe, the different cultures are rediscovering and treasuring their own heritage. And they do it in different ways. So at a European level, we see that there is an association created, the European Fashion Heritage Association, that's part of the Europeana. And Europeana is a digital platform where everybody, there are 40 institutions in 14 countries, European countries, who can put all their fashion heritage images, magazines, fashion pictures online, and it's opened up to the public, to scholars. And so it's really a way to deal with European heritage. And apart from that, of course, each country is also valuing their own heritage. We see it in Flanders, for example, but also in France and Italy, that the last years, a lot of movies are made about fashion designers. For example, a movie about Dior, a movie about Yves Saint Laurent, but also about Dries Van Noten, about Martin Marcella. So it's also a way, by making these movies, to value the heritage of Europe.
Professor Ian, while Annick has been the president, just the immediate past president of the European Network on Cultural Management and Policy, and they took a 9-country tour looking at how, you know, the cultural governance is there practiced within these different countries. So while we're addressing culture, I think fashion and culture are very synonymous in terms of how we're going to address it. But within in a country like India, probably fashion is something that we really don't want to even talk about. Though we want to have it all the time, we spend loads and loads of money, we have all the savings for a fashion, buying a fashion for a wedding, that's how it occurs to us, right? And when you really look at you talking about museums in Europe to promote fashion, to look at conceptual designs, to look at promoting the new craftsmanship. Where did you, while you've been talking about it, Professor Ian has traveled across the globe and he's taken the colloquium to almost 15 countries. And what's your perspective completely, Professor Ian, in terms of how these different nations have looked at fashion while there is a major movement about the decolonizing of fashion? And what's your perspective?
Hi. Hello, India. Hi. You see, I like to see people. That's good. It's good to be here. So let me start by saying I think fashion is going through a very interesting period at the present time. And I think India, as other parts of Asia, will be taking the lead. We are seeing now across the world a transformation. In the past, we saw Europe and we saw America as being the leaders of fashion. That's changing. We're now seeing for the first time that the most important markets for fashion is Asia, and we're seeing China and Asia now leading the way. And I think that's going to be significant. Yes, I can see that. That's good. But I think what we're also seeing is also a realization that fashion needs to be understood in a different way. And I think the presence of fashion at a literature festival is part of that recognition. So what we're seeing is a realization that fashion itself is no longer simply about the latest trends. It's actually now much more significant about identity, about who we are, and most importantly, who we want to express ourselves. And that's being taken up right across the world. One of the reasons why we had the Fashion Colloquia series across the world is that when we started, we looked at the big four, so we had them in these four institutions, certainly, but we had them as part of London Fashion Week. We had part of it as Paris Fashion Week and Milan Fashion Week and New York. So all of these different places were important, but what emerged from it is that Fashion Weeks now are no longer restricted to these four countries. Now that there is almost 200 Fashion Weeks around the world because people are interested in fashion. And more importantly, they're interested in dress, they're interested in clothing, they're interested in identity, they're interested in the kind of responsibility to move to a different form of understanding about the importance of what we wear. We used to have, and I still think we do have, an importance and an interest in high art. But the problem with high art is that it was very elitist. It was over there, it was in museums and in galleries. But what we see in fashion and what we see in clothing and dress is that we see it on the street. We see it in everyday costume. We see it in everyday people's identity. So we're seeing people now moving away from latest trends and being more interested in what they want to say about themselves. And what I want to see, and what I'm really interested in about what we talk about in India, is this notion of heritage and craftsmanship. What we saw in Europe is a period of time where craftsmanship was forgotten. We saw this movement away towards fast fashion and this kind of exploitation that was going through. But now we're seeing in Europe a realization that they're going backwards. They're going back and starting to realize the mistakes that they've made. What India, I think, can learn is not to make that same mistake. Don't follow Europe. It's not the answer. Have your own identity. Be proud of who you are and appreciate your own traditions and your own heritage. That's what you've got to do. If you don't do that, you'll be wasting so much opportunities. So please do that.
Wonderful. So with Himanshu bringing in Etsy from an American concept, so it was prevalent that, you know, data did say that 70% of the sales in a retail store would get into fashion and accessories, right? So is it the same on the online platform that people are buying more of clothing, or is it that it's more about, you know, very different kind of products that are going through your platform?
Yeah, absolutely. So on our platform, apparel is definitely one of the big categories in addition to jewelry and some of the other categories as well. But the beautiful part about, I think Professor Ian talked about the identity of the person who's wearing it. With our platform, with Etsy, it is about identity and story of the person who's making it. Because with every piece that you wear and every maker who's making it, there's a beautiful story behind it. And I think a particular garment or an apparel, when you know the story behind the making process or behind the maker, it adds to a different level of emotional connect to you when you're wearing it as well. So I think that is something that is very important that technology has enabled us to do. In earlier times, or you know, when digital technology wasn't that prevalent, you obviously, you know, there were probably designers who were known. You would go to fashion weeks and discover these people. Now, with online platforms and platforms that are directly connecting buyers with the makers of the products, there's an opportunity for even small independent designers or makers in smallest of parts of India or the world to create their own identity, because otherwise you couldn't do that earlier.
Wonderful. So very interestingly, it just got me present. I was sitting on a summer course where Anik had invited me, Professor Anik had invited me, and they were talking about the hashtag who made my clothes. And it just got present today while I was having another conversation that in the past, when you look at all the heritage textiles or the heritage products and whatever we have as indigenous knowledge, they had a great patronage either from the rural community, the traders, the merchants, and they specially created those products and ideas for that special community. So they knew how it was done. There was a very close intervention in terms of how they would co-create together. So, you know, the whole experience of really who made my clothes was truly existing then in the past. With the mass production, the whole game, it was a game changer. And I wouldn't say it for the good or the bad. That we'll probably see with how people feel about it. But what I truly see is that now it's again getting back to who made my clothes, who made my products, who are the people behind it? Can I co-create with that person? So now here we have a person like Sanjay, who's moved from a small town, and then he's got the top bigwigs of the country that he's dressing up, right? Whether it's Anushka and it's Deepika Padukone, name anybody. So, you know, but he's not labeled as a Bollywood designer yet. He is labeled as somebody who is into conscious clothing, somebody who is into responsible fashion. So while we are going to be addressing about a responsible future, where does Sanjay see his role in creating this responsible future?
Okay, I think I'm going to answer it a little differently. First of all, I want to say that, you know, the way I'm a textile designer, this fashion word always scared me. I tell you how. The whole fashion, what you think of in India, the fashion mean always stitch garments. And when you think of India, I always wondered why not unstitched clothes are part of fashion. And other than that, and it's just very 100 years, it's just 100 years old that we are all wearing some stitched clothes, a pajama, a formal shirt. And if you still see the women, they're wearing a sari, or men wearing a lungi, it doesn't need a sizing. It is definitely has a kept in mind of a weather kind, because, you know, it's quite airy from, you know what I'm saying, and then this doesn't need any sizing, and it's made up of a cotton, and you can pass on to different people. So there is a great thinking. So what my worry about this fashion is in the global, the colleges or the media or institution coming to India is that their idea of fashion is very different. What I don't know whether they want to think about India very, very, you know, from the scratch. I need to have a unique voice. My heritage, my culture, my identity didn't happen overnight. It took thousands of years to reach here what I am. And the color, because the lighting is very different in India, it's pretty bright and people wear color very differently. Our body types are very different. It is very unfortunate. This global world really scares me, actually. I don't know what global means to me, you know. I don't want to be global at all. Because global means if I want to wear everyone to see sneakers, or I want everyone to see pajama or Nike shoes or Adidas, I don't think so I want to see that. And that's what fashion is, you know, a little bit scares me. I don't want to be that the future of India. All I'm trying to see that it need to come from this land, and it actually can come maybe from that land too, but it need to go through great thinking of weather kind, body type, color, identity, culture, religion, politics of this land. Let's not impose. I'm very much against the trend. You know, the trend is the last thing one need to follow. We all care about sustainability. We don't want to, you know, buy too many clothes. Why do we have to buy too many clothes? Cotton consumes too much of water, and what are we going to do it? You talk about sustainability. It's kind of a buying a straw, you know. You saying, okay, this plastic straw, the bamboo straw is better than a plastic straw. But listen, in India, we don't even use a straw. We don't have a concept of a straw. So do not tell us that what is plastic better than a bamboo straw. We don't. You still don't think about it. You don't know how deep in the culture has gone. What is about this, you know, terracotta mug? There's no more. I mean, I don't really want to buy. I mean, I like IKEA design aesthetic visually, but I would like really to question it. How is it made? Is it IKEA made in India or not? I don't know. I like them visually. I'm saying I like IKEA. I can buy them, but I would really ask them, where is it made and how is it made? What is really sustainability means? Is it all about visual sustainability, or do we care about only visual aesthetic? Isn't aesthetic in your senses, your human conscious? What is this aesthetic about? The visual is very beautiful aesthetic. What about the aesthetic you take care of the who's maker or a wearer?
True. Beautiful. So if you hear this, the whole concept of sustainability is also very questionable right now, because what would mean sustainable for somebody else may not be sustainable to my context. So I think that you brought in a very simple example for straw. So something that you cannot really, while we're looking at fashion, there's more of followership, right? So with the Insta and the kind of influencers who are sitting across the globe, are they really telling us that it's all about the aesthetics of dress, the identity, or they're telling us you need to follow this because this is what is in? So I think most of the youngsters today are actually following what Insta says and what fashion should look like. So I think it's a very beautiful
perspective. I just want to add one thing, you know, I really want to know the world how they are. Some of the people who talk about sustainability at the same time they talk about trend, I don't know how you can keep, you know, keep both in mind. I think they are very, very 360 to each other.
Completely agree. And what's your perspective? I think it's a very profound conversation because at one point of, you know, we're talking about the sustainable development goals and we're looking at, you know, water conservation, looking at reducing poverty, having to know who are the people who are making it, how are we increasing the employment. But if one is looking at these areas, how do you really look at the whole fashion management or the, you know, the fashion scenario? So please have your views. Yeah, Annick, please.
Yes, maybe I want to react on what you said because I think at one hand you have the global system from the last 60 years or even longer. And indeed that is based on the Western designers that were outsourcing their production in other countries. And it's in a way now we have a new challenge, I think, because now these countries also see what is their value in the whole value chain. And I think they have to take that in their hands and indeed develop their own fashion industry. That's one thing. Second thing, I think also in Europe we see that the local economy is evolving again. So the young students in the past, 10 years ago or 20, 30 years ago, they still thought when they were graduating from the fashion schools, I want to be in this high-end fashion industry. And they had to become part immediately from this global system. And so we call them also the born globals. But now, young fashion designers realize, no, and also from this sustainability perspective, there is also an opportunity locally. And so it's more sustainable indeed. And there is also an audience. And then I come back to what you said. It's about, what is my engagement? What is my story? And if they tell their story, and they can find their audience, it's still, maybe you're not the big global brand and you will not earn that much money, but it's possible to make your living out of it. So, but it's difficult, but it's possible. And that's a new way of working also in Europe nowadays. So young students who are developing their own business now, and the storytelling is not only important for the smaller ones, but also for the big ones. If we look at even Chanel and Louis Vuitton, they are really using that also in their marketing strategy, their story. And they have fantastic movies. You find them on YouTube, on internet, where you see the story that is going back to their heritage. And it's even one of the movies of Chanel is even not showing the product. It's only the story and with the values that they want to promote. So I think on the global and the local level, there are new
interesting, Professor Annick, because I still see a lot of contradiction. Because on one side, we have the whole startup ecosystem. We've got the venture capitalists. We've got the angel investors who are looking at big size, large size formats, pumping in so much of money. And on the other hand, we're talking about the storytelling thing, where everything small, who made it, is the part. Now, these are two parallel ecosystems existing. And I think while, we do want to undo a lot of things, where do you see as a professor of aesthetics and management? Because the whole consultancy from the management perspective is all about scaling up, how to make more profits. And definitely his model does talk about the humanizing, so it comes back there. So I would like to hear your view on this.
Okay, I think the fashion industry needs to grow up because it needs to realize it has a responsibility now globally that it didn't have maybe a few years ago. I think in the past, the fashion industry can be legitimately criticized for exploitation. And I think that those crimes that it did do across the world is a realization that the fashion industry, and we saw this from the G7 when they signed this agreement in the summer of 2019, a realization they need to take on a different form of future. The days of exploitation, the days of profit without responsibility have to stop. Fashion industry now has to take on a different kind of responsibility about what's it trying to achieve. Now, okay, we can still wear the cheap t-shirts. We can buy 5 t-shirts for a small amount of money, but those kind of t-shirts have a story of exploitation. And every time we put them on our bodies, we need to realize that we are part of that process. So if we take that on and we wear it, we need to own up to that. But on the other hand, if we can then say, okay, this has been made by a sustainable producer, and we can see the stories of that production, and we know why, then I think we should wear that with pride. And that's what we should be doing.
Yep.
So, you know, I'm really trying to understand that in India, what happens is there is a cop there, and they say, oh, you know, that cop doesn't take money. You know, if I break the signal, he won't take the money. He's a nice cop. And okay, if the one nice cop who doesn't take the money, I mean, that's quite rare to us. So to me, I seen the business is called sustainable fashion, and I see the conscious fashion. I want to ask the world, what does it really mean that this is an ethical business? What do you mean if one is ethical, others are not ethical? You say, oh, this is a sustainable brand, that means others are not sustainable. Do we tolerate in this today time which are not sustainable? Is it a speciality? Are you doing something good for me or to the nation or the social economy to being sustainable sustainable or ethical responsible? Isn't it a compulsory thing? So I'm not able to understand that why it's so different that being sustainable, ethical is a speciality or a marketing tool. I don't think that you can sell saying that I'm a sustainable, I'm an ethical, I'm sorry, it's like I'm a nice person, I don't lie. So what?
Wow.
I mean, I don't care about it. I mean, you are sustainable, you need to be sustainable. You say, I'm telling the story, what I have made. I'm sorry, you're not doing anything great to me, you tell me story. I want to know what are the stories behind it, what are the intention behind it, why didn't you tell me the story before? I want to know that what are you doing for this nation and the country, wherever you're selling. I really want to know where the profit are going then. So what is the connection between you, who the consumer of it, and who are wearing of it, and I want to understand what's the connection with the profit and the people who the wearer.
Yeah. Just adding on to that, and I think that's a beautiful point. We work a lot with artisans in Varanasi and Odisha, in tribal areas of Odisha. So we are working with the government of Odisha in tribal districts to kind of contemporize their art form. So we talk about sustainability. Whenever somebody talks about sustainability, it's a beautiful picture of green and environment sustainability that comes to our mind. There's another part about sustainability or being socially responsible is about the conditions of the people who are making these products. And you touched upon this from an exploitation point of view. What has started to happen is also, I feel, when I go and interact with these communities, some of the most rural areas, communities that have been doing it for generations and generations, these are the unsung heroes, you don't even know their faces. When you go and meet them, then I feel that there are some sustainability entrepreneurs who are kind of in some ways exploiting these people. They are these people who are making Banarsi sarees on handloom, which takes about 15 days to make, and sort of not paying them fairly or not caring about what working conditions that are, and then branding this as a sustainable product and not probably even giving enough value to the person who's making it. So I think Sanjay brought he kind of talked about a very, very beautiful point about, thinking about sustainability, not just as sort of a PR thing, but also something that we all should take responsibility for.
So Himanshu, I'd like to throw another one here, because another question, because with 3D and the digital technologies, the augmented reality, that you're not going to have tomorrow, because I can't afford, or anybody can't afford Sanjay.
No, we do have sari from 3000. That's a misconception.
I can. Okay, guys. So that's a good news.
That's
for all
another
of
thing
us.
With a designer of fashion is everything expensive, and everything which is very weirdly cut, or something happening, a tail or something, things come out and I look like a dream is designer. Sorry, that's not what designer is understood of fashion. Design or fashion could be something we look very simple, doesn't have to be drama. Design could be about functionality. It can also 3,000, 4,000. That's exactly what I said. We need to rewrite for India what fashion is and what design is. I think you cannot sell any more craft person the face or the sustainability or this and that. I think that is understood. You need to sell a best product, craft, price. It need to be combination of the wear it need to use for the longest time. So she doesn't have to wear too many clothes. So you save some water. Do not encourage her to wear too many clothes. Let's talk about it. How can we buy less clothing? Actually, why do we always talk about it, the turnover and buy? I don't understand them. Now the time has come that let's buy less. And let's buy less and less. Let's buy something sensible. And you can maybe wear a different world.
Okay, beautiful. So there's a whole new world which is talking about digital fashion, augmented reality. If I can't possess a raw mango, I get to sense a raw mango, have it on my this thing, have a picture shot, and I am in a raw mango, right? So how does this sound to you and you making business out of it? Because institutions in the West who are actually doing a lot of research work in this area are, have young people who are actually now making very good business with out of augmented reality and digital fashion.
So what is digital fashion?
You know why? That's very interesting. So, which means that you have a silk, beautiful Banarsi, you have sensors or whatever that can get you to feel the silk, and you don't have this thing, but you can really see yourself draped in a raw mango.
Okay.
You've got a nice Insta pic.
Okay.
You've got a nice Facebook pic, and you said, and you pay for that, but you actually don't possess it in your world.
So listen, see, I'm a little bit of old school of thought. My younger brother absolutely into e-commerce, and he talks about all this. I never got it. So I want to ask you, when we had nothing to wear 5,000 years ago, 10,000 years ago, for a sex, you need to have a person or a drink or a food. I'm asking you, can on internet, can I drink a Coca-Cola or a drink of water? Can I have a sex with someone on internet? I don't think so. I want to say that is a reality. I don't know. I mean, you can tell me, I look like this on internet, but I don't think it's a reality. And it's a 10,000 year old thing when we have nothing to wear. We were in caves. I think certain things remain the same. I'm not discounting complete the e-commerce, but I'm just also questioning it. The human emotion, the experience, the smell of the Mogra, the certain architect, how do I feel it in this pandalo, that pandalo weather? I don't know whether I feel on internet. You can try your best, but I'm okay.
I'll ask Anik, they're very interesting. We are the most crazy creatures because we want unpredictability, yet want to be predictable. So we are always switching between predictability and unpredictability. And that's why the aspiration of creating something new is there in us. And I think, you know, while we all have a very basic needs, as Gandhiji or all of philosophy says, you know, there's always space for anybody's need on the planet, but no space for people's greed. So I think the whole idea of greed is, you know, wanting to have more and more, and probably even when we're looking at the digital technology, probably this might again fade very soon. We don't know about it, right? But it is there in the space, and Anik wants to say something about it.
Yes. Yeah, I think technological, a lot of is possible. Yeah? But it depends still of the behavior of the people, if they will adapt it. And I think it all will never replace the creativity. But still, even if it is augmented reality, you still need a design. And so, and that's then about the experience. And we have to see how people will react on that. But it's a question of also finding then a new business model, how to earn money from that. Because I think it's on top of it. Eh? It will never replace also the more authentic way of
one very small thing. You know, I remember going to villages. Whenever I went, you know, I used to have this computer. All my people used to think, you know, the day I'll get a computer, I'll become, you know, I don't need you. So a lot of people think that this computer has the storage design and they'll give me design, you know. So I don't think so. People think that it's just a medium, it's a tool.
So a lot of people, they thought probably it's a goal, yeah. It's an end, but not a tool. So now I think that whole awareness is now again coming that it's just a tool. Because if the new craftsmanship, the digital craftsmanship is the new craftsmanship, I see a lot of young people, so they have a choice. Whether they want to stick to the traditional craftsmanship or they want to take on to the new craftsmanship. And I think that is a conscious choice that each human being has. And while there is a space for both kind of worlds to coexist. And I think the beauty is when they coexist and they can be enablers for each other and they can actually create an ecosystem where both of them are creators where they are, you know, refined, they've got the right aesthetics, they've got the right kind of thing, but it is again a matter of choice, what do you want to have? So I am somebody who like completely tactile. There's somebody who would just purely like to be getting in that sense and have it on the social media. So I think again it's about when we talk about a responsible future, each one of us has to make a conscious choice at the level of the self what is going to be truly responsible, because understanding the concepts of being responsible might completely, you know, take one's true self from really knowing what's responsible. I think because there's a whole, because there are new concepts coming every day. So Ian, while you've written the book on the aesthetics of dress, what was your whole context about? Why did you even think that this need to be written down? Because you remember when you used the word dress, I said for India, when you say dress, it's a uniform. It's like my school uniform or the police uniform, and we would not relate a dress as a dress. So it's very interesting. So different cultures see a dress or craftsmanship very differently as how we would see. So you have a very good perspective.
I mean, I think what I would like to say is that there's two things I'd like to say. The first thing is, I think fashion, as I said at the beginning, has changed a lot. And I think what we saw, what we're seeing, and have seen in the last 40, 50 years in Europe, is a very top-down approach to fashion. And it really is, you've seen the fashion leaders pushing the certain designs and certain things. That's changing. We are seeing something, and I think India should lead the way here. We should see fashion in India as being very bottom-up. I want to see much more individual designs, because the aesthetics of dress really was a book really talking about that fashion is no longer about impression. It's, you know, that was the old, you know, that was the old story. Fashion now is about expression and the ability for you to express yourselves. Don't follow, be a leader.
Beautiful. So fashion is not about, impression, it's about expression. So I think that's beautiful. I think there are a lot of young people here and the message is going as stop being followers and be truly original, to be truly feeling that you're responsible. So I think Himanshu has something to say.
I just want to pick on Sanjay's conversation. I think he's absolutely right about it. Whether it's a textile or you want to physically feel it, you want to smell the clothing that comes with it, I don't think anybody can replace it. It's the same way. Like, I am a voracious reader. I have hundreds of books. I'm from a technology industry, but I still read the physical book. I want to see it. I want to feel it. However, what technology can help with is reduce the wastage that comes with the development of the final product. And I think the digital mediums will help you to do simulation of the final product, and whatever sampling that you need to do, whatever product development needs to do, what kind of fabric that you need to use, that can cut out quite drastically. Sort of just adding to your point and just supporting your point, we're talking about people should probably buy less. A 3D technology or a simulation technology that'll help people to sort of fulfill their need for putting it on social media, then they don't need to buy the product to put it on social media. They can just use it as a digital thing. So I don't think it's going anywhere. People are still going to wear real clothes and textile. We are actually going back to our heritage of the way we did things hundreds of years back, and that is very encouraging to see, not just across the world but in India as well. But digital just aids you to do it in a more thoughtful manner.
Lovely. So I think we can conclude the session that, the more and more opportunity is growing for us. While we have our crafts, our heritage on this side, we have the digital technologies. There is a marriage that can happen between these two at all times. While India can go to the other parts of the world, the Western world can come here. So I feel the whole realm of exploitation or the you know, the space that we were into with the colonizing of that kind of you know, with countries being going to different countries and actually putting the product for mass production or as using it as and putting as consumer base for other countries. Now, while the countries have taken also the stance that they're not going to allow these dumping grounds anymore, they're not going to have them being exploited anymore, I think the opportunity is rather growing for us rather than getting less. So I think both these worlds are going to coexist in the new shared economy that we are talking about. So we're going to have some new fresh narratives, and I think we've heard some fresh narrative today, and I think this is going to become also a part of a very fruitful conversation being at the Jaipur Literature Festival, where there's so many people who've really heard, because there's, you know, fashion purely simply means it's like, you know, you're just buying one, wearing one, and having it obsolete as it's not required. And a person like me, you know, I was just thinking that I picked up something like this 2 days before and I'm wearing this right now. That's how, and a blouse that's 5 years back, a jacket that's 10 years back, and that's how I can club it up, I can put it all together, and I have a new attire. And I've never seen anybody just come across and tell me, wow, this is looking amazing, because it's just the saris worn differently. So I think it's very interesting how people need to really look at their identity, what they want to do, how they want to embrace fashion. And I think the opportunity is now more in terms of truly expressing, because we are all becoming more open with the digital technology for sure, because it's giving us more access to different parts of the world, knowing what's going on. So the choices are now becoming more, we can be really working on our choices rather than becoming followers. I think so Ian put up a very good thing that, you know, fashion and followership is something that we need to break. Anik put up the whole new realm of, you know, fashion management that really needs to address, where it's looking at your story. The story is something that young people are talking about. And I think Sanjay had a nice time being very easy about it and talking about really making a difference, where it's about really understanding that sustainability is something that's very personal. And I truly feel that sustainability is very personal. And I think everybody wants to get into the bandwagon of sustainability, and that's not the correct thing to do. And with Himanshu completely bringing the new shared future with a lot of people who really can relate with technology and digital, I think this panel has been amazing. With all different perspectives coming together. So thank you so much, and we can keep the house open for questions.
And I read a story, is about the wastage of water, the gallons of water for the making the clothes. So that's why I'm asking the, I just want to ask you, because now the fashion is a very expressive way. So I just want to know that how can you aware the youngsters and the fashion lovers to be sustainable and don't take many clothes and clothes. I think in their dome there are a lot of people who have the full wardrobe of the clothes. So how can we aware the people? How can we save? And second question is that the fashion designer give the innovation like this kind of cut, this kind of cut. And people are thinking that it's new. So that's why people are want to take by taking by and again and again. So what's about your opinion for that?
So first of all, as you said, the fashion is all about the new cuts and new thing. I did say that fashion doesn't mean always that. Fashion could be new fabric and comfortable. And I know I'm answering you. So you know that there is something called textile and fashion too. So I think, as I said, so I don't believe in trends. So we should not talk about trends. And not everything new is nice. One need to see, you should not wear it just because celebrity is wearing it. Your body type and your needs are different. Your pocket demands differently. All we're saying is that you need to wear something which you care more often.
And I, as a brand, don't believe in trend, as I said, and that's why I also don't believe in that was an old collection, a new collection. We don't care. We don't. We also sell things of 4 years old, you know. So we don't say because the old collection is going on discounted. So I think that's exactly what I said. The fashion is not only about the new thing; it's also about the material, feel, the way you can wear it, touch and feel, weave, textile pattern. It's just not about new cuts. I think we are misinterpreting fashion here.
Yeah, so that's where the whole myth is, because if you look at the fashion colloquium, we've kept this sub-theme, which is myths to meaning, narratives towards sustainable futures. Because there is a lot of myth when we talk about the mythology as one myth, and the myth that carries with the mythology or the understanding of how we are understanding things. There's also myth around it. So fashion has a lot of myths, that's for sure. So we have a lot of amazing people here sitting in the audience who have actually broken this myth, right from Uba Prajapati to Pratima Pandey, they're big designers, and here Sanjay. So they've really broken this myth. Aap gaon se nikle, bilkul aapne wo dekha, aapne fashion ke andar mein people embraced it. The Bollywood embraced it. The celebrities embraced it. So aap dekhiye ki kitna sara myth aam aadmi mein hai. The common man has so much of myth.
I said I don't believe in trends. A, you didn't listen to me. B, I am not representative of a whole fashion world. They don't listen to me. They don't come to me and ask me, Sanjay, what should I do? No, I can only be answer for myself. I don't believe in trend, and you can hold me responsible for this if I do. Thank you.
Any more questions? Yeah.
There are a lot of talking about the maker in this session. So there are so many art and craft which are going from generation to generation, but suddenly in last 20-25 years, this generation of the people from the craft and artisans don't want to continue the legacy, because it's not because they don't like to do that, because there is not enough money and there is very niche market for that. So what measure should be taken to motivate those next generation artisans and craftsmen should be taken to continue their craft?
Sir, it's an extremely complex question, and I'm going to answer you. Okay, I'll tell you, first of all, we see as a craftsman and artisan somewhere else. So when we talk about the woman who runs NGOs in Delhi or Calcutta, Mumbai, they go to villager and the weaver, and they say they encourage weaver son to weave. I'm asking, are they encouraging their own son to weave? I'm asking you, do you go to English medium schools and ask them to weave or become craftisan? You are very elitist if you think that because their artisan son or artisan going to keep doing what they're doing. You cannot impose them, that's your work and that's what you need to do. Why are not you an artisan, I'm asking you. Why are not you a weaver? Why are you a carpenter? It's a very elitist point of view. You can't tell them what to do. They want to be computer designer, they want to be fashion designer, they want to be dancer, they want to be singer.
Yeah, can I just add one thing to it actually?
I never understood this in India. I mean, why? I mean, who are these people?
Totally.
And who are you to tell them?
And you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. And that's what we have seen when... So we are making an attempt to get a lot of traditional artisans to sell to globally. And one of the things that we struggle with a lot of times that these people are not digitally enabled. They are just excellent makers and craft people, but they're not digitally enabled. What we have seen, the younger generation who might not have taken up the craft form, they are helping their parents and grandparents because they are so digitally exposed. They are helping their parents and grandparents to get online and sell globally. So maybe I think with these digital mediums, that's the attempt that we need to make. Even if they are not directly taking it up, if they are helping the older generation, and maybe there's an interest that will come not just as the legacy of their parents, but even in my daughter or my son, that they would take up these craft forms when they see that encouragement from a global audience.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay, so we have because we have the fashion colloquium starting tomorrow with so many researchers who've traveled from across the globe, and this is an apt book of all the proceedings here. So we would like the panel to just open the proceedings for us and sign it.